Good morning. We are so glad you joined us today for worship here at Forest Hill Christian Church.
When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will
name them one by one. Count your blessings.
sorrows, I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. Yeah. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. I'm pressed but not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. I am blessed beyond the curse, for His promise will endure, that His joy is gonna be my strength.
Destroy us.
I like the story that's told of the male school teacher who had back surgery over the summer, and he began the school year wearing this solid plastic cast, if you will, around the upper part of his body. It fit under his shirt, and it wasn't very noticeable at all. And on the first day of school, he found himself assigned to literally the toughest students in the school. And so walking confidently into the crowd, as you might imagine, you know, stiff, upright, those kinds of things, as he walked into this rowdy classroom, he opened the window as wide as possible and then busied himself with work at his desk. And when a strong breeze made his tie flap into the air, he took the desk stapler in full view of all the students and he stapled the tie to his chest. Now, needless to say, he had no discipline problems that year in the classroom. You know, there is a healthy fear and respect that all of us need to have for those who are in authority over us, and that is especially true with respect to God. It's kind of like the cartoon I saw once. The sign in front of this particular church building says, "Welcome, putting the fear of God in folks since 1874. Now, how do you react to that? You know, do you think that it's a bad thing or a good thing? Well, it's important for us to strive, I think, for a balance by emphasizing God's love and His grace on the one hand, and God's holiness, His justice, and yes, even His wrath on the other hand. Therefore, the billboard is an appropriate one when it says, "Fear God. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom." A truth often repeated in Scripture, certainly, and especially in Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7. But I'm afraid that we are often far too casual in our approach to God. I'm afraid that many contemporary conceptions of God, if you will, are far too shallow and even small. God is not our buddy. He's not our pal or our bellboy. Our God is holy, and He is exalted above all. He is the only wise God, the Creator, the sovereign Lord and Master. He tells us what to do, and we have really no safe option but to obey. There's no alternative, no multiple choice. We have but one directive, and that is to do His will. A shallow view of God leads us to a shallow life. Treat God superficially and flippantly, and we become superficial and flippant people. Often our obedience to God might as well depend on the flip of a coin. Heads we do, tails we don't. If we feel like it, great. If I don't, well, He's a God of grace, right? And certainly He will understand and go easy on us, right? Frankly, we don't find such accommodating nonsense in Scripture. Certainly not in a passage like Exodus chapter 19, where we find our story today as we follow through the life of Moses and now the Israelites joined together. And so I want us to take a look at Moses meeting with God, and I want us to see what we might need to learn about our own meeting with God. So our story opens here in Exodus chapter 19, and it opens in the shadows, if you will, of Mount Sinai. This holy mountain. It's become a particular mountain, not only in Scripture, but we'll talk about it through historical perspective. The Israelites have been in the desert now for about 3 months, and they now have arrived at the mountain, which happens to be the same place where Moses' whole adventure began earlier. It was there and then that God made the promise. Back in Exodus chapter 3, it's recorded for us, "And this will be a sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain." And so here they are. They've arrived, just as God had promised. Now, chances are that few of us have ever been or ever will be, literally, to Mount Sinai. And so let's try to get an appreciation, if you will, with me for this amazing and majestic sight. Mount Sinai is a series, literally, of solid granite peaks that soar into the desert sky at the base of the Sinai Peninsula. In a book about Mount Sinai called God's Wilderness, there's a photo with this particular caption. It says, "The awe-inspiring granite peaks at the southern tip of the Sinai Peninsula seem to form a gigantic fist of God proclaiming, 'Here, here.'" The book goes on and adds, "Israeli scholars who explored the peninsula in the brief period of Israeli occupation came to experience a holiness pervading Sinai's mountains." Well, the Israelites gathered as a people, approximately 2 million strong, to hear God's voice in the shadow of these peaks that reach no less than 8,000 feet heavenward. Now, as you recall from our lesson a couple of weeks ago, the Israelites did a lot of grumbling, did a lot of complaining as they made their move toward this particular place. There's always a need to prepare ourselves before entering into God's presence. And so I want us to notice this morning the four prerequisites, if you will, God required of his people before they could meet with him. The first prerequisite was a willingness to obey. Now, you might remember a couple of weeks ago as well that I mentioned to you that part of what was happening with God's people, and even some of the scripture itself, pointed out the idea that he wanted to see if his people, Israelites, would follow his instructions. The Bible begins in Exodus chapter 19, verse 3, when it says, "Then Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain and said, 'This is what you are to say to the house of Jacob and what you are to tell the people of Israel. You yourselves have seen what I did to Egypt and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words you are to speak to the Israelites.'" God wanted to be sure that his words did not fall on deaf ears. So he required his people to display a willingness to obey. Now, many of us have likely assumed somehow that Moses climbed the mountain once, got everything, then came back down with those stone tablets tucked under his arms. But that's really not the case. A careful study of Exodus shows us that he actually made about 7 different trips up and down on that mountain. And on his first journey up the mountain, God said, "I want to be sure the people are willing to obey." So Moses comes back down the mountain. The Bible continues the story in chapter 19, verse 7. It says, "So Moses went back and he summoned the elders." So he's come back down the mountain. He summoned the elders of the people and set before them all the words the Lord had commanded him to speak. The people all responded together, "We will do everything the Lord has said." So Moses brought their answer back to God. Back up he goes. The second prerequisite is this, that it was a commitment to listen to God and Moses. All right, so they've got this obey thing that's going to have to happen, but they also have to make this commitment to listen to God and to Moses. And so the Bible tells us in verse 9, "The Lord said then to Moses, 'I'm going to come to you in a dense cloud so that the people will hear me speaking with you and will always put their trust in you.'" So God says, "Hey, listen, I want them to know that it's me speaking to you and they can trust what you say." So then Moses told the Lord what the people had said. God was laying the groundwork for communication with the people through Moses. They had to be ready to hear and to obey. The third prerequisite this morning was a consecration of themselves. This third prerequisite, a consecration of themselves. Verse 10 continues, "And the Lord said to Moses, 'Go to the people,'" so he's going back down to the people, "'and consecrate them today and tomorrow. Have them wash their clothes and be ready by the third day, because on that day the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people.'" We jump down to verse 14. "After Moses had gone down the mountain to the people, he consecrated them and they washed their clothes. Then he said to the people, 'Prepare yourselves for the third day. Abstain from sexual relations.'" Their clean garments were to reflect their clean hearts. And abstaining from sex was not so much an issue of holiness, but as an issue of devotion and focus, to keep their not only consecration, but their concentration as well. God wanted the people's full attention on Him and on what He was about to tell them. The final prerequisite, number four of these, was a respect for God's boundaries and His presence. God says in verse 12, those verses we skipped over a moment ago, "Put limits for the people around the mountain and tell them, 'Be careful that you do not go up the mountain or touch the foot of it. Whoever touches the mountain shall surely be put to death. He shall surely be stoned or shot with arrows. Not a hand is to be laid on him. Whether man or animal, he shall not be permitted to live. Only when the ram's horn sounds a long blast may they go up to the mountain.'" God made it very clear that not everyone could come up the mountain, but only those who were authorized to do so. He was setting some boundaries. You know, literally, so deep and profound was to be this particular respect for God's holy presence that no one was even to touch the mountain. This was God's mountain, and it was He who set the rules. I find it interesting that those who did not respect God's boundaries would lose their lives. But I need you to notice how they were to lose their lives. I'm surprised that God didn't intend to kill anyone directly. It wasn't like, "I'm going to strike you down, there's a lightning bolt coming." But rather, He puts the responsibility back on His people to enforce His boundaries. God expects us to respect and enforce the boundaries that He has put in place. So the story continues. We move on to verse 16. "On the morning of the third day, there was thunder and lightning with a thick cloud over the mountain and a very loud trumpet blast. Everyone in the camp trembled. Then Moses led the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. Mount Sinai was covered with smoke because the Lord descended on it in fire. The smoke billowed up from it like smoke from a furnace. The whole mountain trembled violently, and the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder. Then Moses spoke, and the voice of God answered him. The Lord descended to the top of Mount Sinai and called Moses to the top of the mountain. So Moses went up, and the Lord said to him, 'Go down and warn the people so they do not force their way through to see the Lord, and many of them perish. Even the priests who approach the Lord must consecrate themselves, or the Lord will break out against them.' Moses said to the Lord, 'The people cannot come up Mount Sinai because you yourself warned us. Put limits around the mountain and set it apart as holy.' And the Lord replied, 'Go down and bring Aaron up with you. But the priests and the people must not force their way through to come up to the Lord, or He will break out against them.' So Moses went down to the people and he told them." Can you imagine being there and seeing these awesome sights and sounds? Thunder, lightning, a loud trumpet blast, the trembling ground, the smoke. I don't know. Would you have been tempted to go beyond the boundaries and touch the mountain? I'm as curious as anybody, but I'm not sure I want to touch that mountain. Yet it appears that the people were tempted to do just that. And so God forced Moses, literally, repeatedly, "Go down, go down, go down. Tell them." He forced Moses to go back down the mountain and warn the people one more time. And then look at Exodus chapter 20. We get all the way down to verse 18 in this chapter. And it says, "When the people saw the thunder and the lightning and heard the trumpet, saw the mountain and smoke, they trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance and said to Moses, 'Speak to us yourself and we will listen, but do not have God speak to us or we will die.' Moses said to the people, 'Do not be afraid. God has come to test you so that the fear of God will be with you to keep you from sinning.' The people remained at a distance while Moses approached the thick darkness where God was." You know, a healthy fear of God will do much to deter us from sin. And yet, tragically, mankind has never been obedient to God for very long. Our story moves on in Exodus chapter 24, and it says, beginning in verse 12, the Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and stay here, and I will give you the tablets of stone with the law and commands I have written for their instruction." Then Moses set out with Joshua, his aide, and Moses went up on the mountain of God, and he said to the elders, "Wait here for us until we come back to you. Aaron and Hur are with you, and anyone involved in a dispute can go to them." So you've got somebody to take care of you. When Moses went up on the mountain, verse 15 continues, the cloud covered it, and the glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai for 6 days. For 6 days, the cloud covered the mountain, and on the seventh day, the Lord called to Moses from within the cloud. To the Israelites, the glory of the Lord looked like a consuming fire on top of the mountain. Then Moses entered the cloud as he went on up the mountain, and he stayed on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. Basically, from Exodus chapter 20 all the way down through Exodus chapter 31, God gave Moses the Ten Commandments. Now, that's a story for another day as we think about those ideas. But he gave him those commandments and the rest of the law. And Moses is gone now for 40 days, and he came down the mountain to find God's people basically breaking all 10 of the Ten Commandments. What a disappointment and a disaster. But that too is another story for another time. But I want us to marvel for a moment at the fact that God has given us His written word. God has given us His word that we might know Him and that we might know His mind and that we might be blessed by obeying His will. God didn't want to remain aloof at a distance high up on a mountain. God wanted to make Himself accessible and available to us because He wants a relationship with us. I wonder today, do we take for granted the fact that we have God's Word so available to us? Back before the collapse of the Soviet Union, a Christian publisher was allowed to attend the Moscow Book Fair. The authorities had granted reluctant permission to hand out a limited number of Russian language New Testaments, little New Testaments. A long line of people formed hoping to receive a copy. And when the supply of Bibles was exhausted, one desperately disappointed man asked if he might have one of the empty boxes that had once held the New Testaments. The Christian publisher's representative who was there at the show said, "You know, but there's nothing in the box. The Bibles are all gone." The story goes, with tears in his eyes, that Russian man replied, then I at least want the box." He so desired to have a Bible that he treasured even the cardboard box that had held it. May indeed our eyes be open to the astounding privilege that is ours to hold the written Word of God and study it for ourselves. Today's study of the Israelites and Moses' meeting with the Lord suggests three principles that I want us to pick up on and apply, if we can, to our own walk of faith. Now, I have to confess to you that I found this study to be very convicting even to me, because I personally have at times allowed my own spiritual disciplines to become far too sporadic and inconsistent. So I needed a lesson like this one as much as anyone else, to get my priorities in line the way God needs them to be. I read this recently about busyness and its effects on our spiritual lives, effect on spiritual things. It said it this way: "Do you know what busy stands for? Being under Satan's yoke." B-U-S-Y. Being under Satan's yoke. You know, we might want to give that some consideration. The first principle for us, I think, this morning, as we can gather from today's story, is that meeting with God should be a priority. Now, we can look at that in all different kinds of ways this morning, and certainly gathering in His house with His believers is a big part of that, but we're much more fundamental. Meeting with God should be a priority. It is both a privilege and a necessity that we meet with the Lord. Meeting with the Lord involves worshiping with the body. That's one part of it. But it also involves our private walk with God. You see, God expects us to do our best to gather consistently with our brothers and sisters, both for our good and for theirs. Hebrews reminds us, in fact, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, reminds us that we should not give up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but we should spur one another on toward love and good works. But beyond the times when we gather together for our group worship or Bible study or fellowship, we need a daily time alone with God. And the more consistent that can be, the better. And that usually means that we need a specific time and a place for our meeting with God. We're free to choose that time and place that works best for us, but we need to make sure we develop that time and place. And here's something else. I need you to expect, literally, that Satan is going to do everything he can to keep you from that time and place. Because he knows the power and the benefit that comes from regularly meeting with God. And so what is your time and place? If you don't have one, I pray that God would convict you in such a way and help you make a time and a place. The second principle we can gather from today's story, I think, is that we need to prepare ourselves as we meet the Lord. Not only do we need to meet Him, make it a priority, but we need to prepare ourselves. There is a consecration that needs to take place as we approach our meeting with the Lord. This consecration includes a repenting and a confessing of our sins, certainly. We need to approach God with clean hearts and minds and lives, just like the children of Israel were instructed. This consecration includes a willingness to hear Him and to obey the Lord. We should not fool ourselves and play games with God. We must be ready to obey and submit to God and His will. Now, this consecration also includes a focusing, if you will, of our minds on spiritual things. You know, I find that reading or maybe even singing a hymn and maybe some spiritual courses are some of the best way to begin to focus my mind and heart on the Lord. I personally have some real worship time sitting at a piano singing a few little songs. You might want to have a hymnal available to prepare you as you begin your time with God, or you might find having some Christian CD or music going in the background is helpful to you. The final principle that we gather from today's story is that we need to listen to God through His Word. God has given us His book. And when we meet with God, it is to His book that we must look. Now, I wouldn't suggest just flipping randomly from page to page or verse to verse, but I would suggest starting at the beginning of a book of the Bible and working our way through it slowly and systematically. There are times when a certain subject is on your mind, perhaps, and a concordance can help, some Bible study help that can help you find verses that discuss that particular topic. But the Bible literally is best read and studied as a whole in context. Feel free to read the Word aloud. I know that feels kind of weird, maybe sitting in a room by yourself sometimes, but read it thoroughly, read it prayerfully, personalize it, sing it maybe. It might help you to even write down the main idea you've learned from your daily reading so that you can think about it the rest of the day. You see, God wants us to have a relationship with Him. God wants to meet with us individually and collectively. God wants to mold us and to strengthen us, but we must make ourselves available to God. We have to make it a priority to meet with the Lord. We must consecrate ourselves and come ready to learn and to obey. May we never treat God casually. May we always approach God with the proper reverence and fear. For as the Hebrew writer said, our God is a consuming fire. Let me leave you with this question. Will you make a renewed commitment to give more consistent attention to the things that will help you draw near to God? Thanks again for joining us today. It's been a pleasure to share and worship with you at Forest Hill Christian Church. We're going to close our time in prayer today. Would you bow with me as we pray? God, thank you so much for the opportunity to gather in worship and in praise. And Father, we know that it takes all different forms as we share together these days. And so we pray your blessing upon each one, whether we are together in person, whether we are, Father, listening on the radio or from the comfort of our home. Father, we thank you for the blessing of Jesus Christ and the fact that we indeed can worship him anywhere. Father, we thank you for the fellowship that is ours in Jesus Christ, and we long to share that fellowship again with fellow believers. Thank you, Father, for Jesus, his great sacrifice on the cross of Calvary. Father, that through his death, burial, and resurrection, there is life everlasting for us. Thank you for loving us to that degree. Father, we would ask that you would walk with us on this journey of life. Help us, Father, to be your children, to be pleasing and honorable in your sight, so that the world might see and give glory to you, our Father. In Jesus' name, amen.